Very warm welcome to all of you who set this goal to be here at 2 o'clock every Saturday. That's also a goal. So when we talk about setting goals, there is such a wide variety, no? See, let's start with children. I get so amused that somebody goes to visit somebody else and there is a child in the house. And that visitor, you know, wants to be nice to the child and says, "Hello, beta, come here, sit down. Oh, you're so nice. Which school do you study? Which class are you in?" And the poor child has no option but to tell which school and which class. The next thing they ask is, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" Now that child has not been given any inputs on these goals called career goals or deciding upon education career path. But we are very, very, you know, regular in asking children, "What do you want to do when you grow up?" So there are some children who don't know, and they frankly admit, "I don't know." There are some who want to impress their parents or the other adults and say, "I want to become a doctor and I want to find a cure for cancer. Areva, look at this little one. How nice, you know, what a noble goal. Very good. God bless you." They say all that. Then there are some very courageous children who say, "When I grow up, I want to be a F1 car racing driver, or I want to be a film star." And immediately the reaction is, no, you can't have that type of goals, no? You should be serious, you should study, you should get good qualifications, and you must have a stable career by which you can look after the rest of your life and your family. Okay, this happens with children. What about when we grow up? Nobody asks, "What are your goals?" For example, that same visitor doesn't ask the father or the mother, "What are your goals in life?" Because we are presuming that once you have become an adult, you don't need to have goals. You have achieved whatever it is. Now the rest of your life, you do what you want. I was very amused when I had gone once, I remember, to a friend's house. And his wife came and said, "Bhai Sahab, you are a counselor. I want you to please, you know, talk to my daughter. She has come to PUC and she still doesn't have any direction, any goals. Yeah, she's a good student, she's studying, but she has to decide, you know, what to do and all that. And I'm very, very upset with her. What will happen?" It was a Sunday. That poor kid was enjoying herself, maybe listening to music or chatting with her friends. Her mother drags her down and says, "See, this uncle, you know, he's a counselor and he will help you. He will tell you what you should do when you come." I could make out by the expression of the kid that she was least interested in this uncle. Anyway, I had to sit there. I was the guest. Then the mother says, "See, when I was her age, no, I was a very good student. I was a topper in my class and I wanted to become a doctor. But, you know, my family, we were so conservative. They said, no, being a daughter, being a girl, you know, how can you become a doctor? You have to go on and on studying for years and we can't even afford that," or something like that. So what they did was they put me into arts and they said, "You complete your BA." By the time I was in final year, they got me married off. Then I had these kids and all that. I've been looking after my family. See, I'm 39 years old now. My life is over. It doesn't matter. I don't have any great ambitions, but I want my daughter to do well and we are going to back her up. We don't mind even sending her abroad for higher studies if she wants to achieve something great in life. So I want her to have that ambition. Anyway, I sat and spoke for a few minutes to the daughter. I realized that she's just not interested. I gave her a few tips here and there. And the moment I said, "Okay, you can go," she happily ran away. But after she went, I was talking to the mother. I said, "You know what you have done? You have told your daughter that you should be ambitious. You should study hard. You should not waste time. The more you struggle, the more you study, the more you get good marks, you can do this, this, this. In the same breath, you told your daughter, I am 39 years old. My life is over. I don't have anything great to look forward to. So I am happy with what I am. Now, what is the message reaching the daughter? That when I am 39, I will be like my mother. I will say, my life is over. Now I have to look after the family and children. I don't have any ambitions. If life is going to be like that at 39, then at 16, I should make the most and enjoy life. Why should I waste my time now? Now that is what I am trying to say. That when we talk about goals and all that, what is wrong if a child is studying well, getting good marks and says, I don't have a goal in life? What is wrong if somebody is 60 years old, is retiring and says, now let me plan my life ahead and see what goals I can set and what can I do in the rest of my life? So it works both ways. That brings me to a very primary question, that is, are goals necessary in life? At any stage of life, whatever stage you are in, is it necessary to have goals? The answer is conditional, but since I use the word necessary in the question, I would say no. It is not necessary to have goals. But if you say, I don't want to think of the future, I don't want to plan ahead, I want to live life one day at a time, nothing wrong with it. But also remember that once time goes past, you can never get it back. The one resource that you have at your command, which can never be brought back, is time. You have wealth, you spend it off, you can again earn it. Your health goes bad, you can get treatment, again get back to good health. Your relationship goes bad, you can always build relationships or rebuild relationships. You lose a job, you can always get another job. But if you lose time, you can never get it back. So, are you sure that if I do not set goals, if I don't look into the future, I just want to relax and enjoy life, living one day at a time? Are you sure you are not going to regret it in the future? If that is your temperament, that is your personality, and that is your outlook in life, I will not regret, then it is perfectly fine for you not to have goals. At the same time, remember that goals give you a sense of direction. They give you some motivation, whatever the goal is. My goal could be that I want to sit with my child and teach him very well so that he does very well academically. That's also a goal. I may have a goal that I want to learn music or to play an instrument and I want to become proficient in it so that people appreciate that I play music very well. That is also a goal. I want to develop a hobby. I want to make a nice garden. I've got some open space in my house. I want to develop a garden. That is also a goal. So goals are not necessarily to do with academics, careers, earning money and stuff like that. So if you find that you can set yourself some goals, you know what happens is you are moving in the right direction. If I get out of Banjara right now, and if I say, today evening, I need to be at our retreat called Manthan, what happens? I know which road to take. I decide whether I want to use my vehicle or use public transport or request somebody to give me a lift. And most important, I must learn how to enjoy the journey. See, when we say goals, somebody, let's say, puts up a goal saying that I want to build a nice big house for myself. I don't have sufficient money. So I will start earning, I will start saving. I will buy a good plot of land, even if it is far away, so that it is cheap. And as the city develops and goes in that direction, I will be able to live there peacefully. Then I get an architect to design it for me. Then I set a budget. Then when I realize that this money is not enough, I apply for a loan. I get the loan. Then I need a good contractor who's going to build that structure for me. Then I need an interior designer. Then I need to buy furniture. I do all that. And now, instead of living in that small two-room house where I was earlier, now I am living in a nice, luxurious house, which is mine. It belongs to me. Does it necessarily make me happy? No. What happens is that you start aiming higher. Now that I have a house, I have this old second-hand car. It doesn't look nice in such an impressive house. I should buy a big car. I should dress up well. I should throw parties so that people can come and admire my house. See how your goals keep going higher and higher and higher. But if you are the type of person who enjoys the journey, who sets certain goals which are not, you know, end oriented but process oriented. In academics, if a person says, I want to get an MBA from IIM, that is an end goal. But instead of that, if you have a process goal which says, I want to learn more and more about management so that I go higher, I rise into better positions, I become more competent. Now, whether I get admission in IIM, whether I go to some other B school, or whether I learn on the job, I am going towards that goal of becoming a competent professional or manager. And that is why I said the process, the journey, that is what you should, you know, look towards and start enjoying whatever you are doing. There's another factor. There are a lot of people, you know, who keep changing goals from time to time. It's like you want to go from one city to another. You know that national highway so and so takes you there. So you start off on that highway. Then you come to know that there is a roadblock. You change your direction. You take a detour, you go on to some other road. From there you take a roundabout. And then you say, here the roadblock is not there, so I'll come back to the original highway and I'll continue there. Somewhere along the line you may say, there are no good eateries here. So there is this town. If I take a diversion and go inside the town, I can get very good food. So deviate, go into the town, get some nice food to eat, and then again from there proceed towards your direction. So the best people, the most satisfied people are those who keep setting goals along the way. Also, I wanted to share with you that goals need not be only about material things. I want to improve my relationship with my father or with my son. That can be a very nice goal. And since, as I said, it's not an end goal, it's a process goal. Every time I improve a little bit of my relationship, I feel that satisfaction. I feel nice. And it gives me the impetus, the motivation, as I mentioned earlier, to put in more and more efforts. I also come across a lot of women, ladies, who are told that old traditional thing, no? That in your childhood, you will be controlled by your father. When you grow up, your husband will control you. And when you become old, your son will control you. You have to listen to what they say. Maybe it had some wisdom in the good old days when women were very, very vulnerable. But today that is definitely not there, no? So you can't say that this is our culture. In our family, no woman works. Yes, in your family, your grandfather used to go to school in a bullock cart. Will you send your son in a bullock cart to the school? So, unless there is something wrong with it, unless there is something unethical, you can definitely start bringing about changes as long as it suits, your thinking, your way of life, and most important, as long as you are not hurting somebody, then you know that you are on the right track. And I reiterate again that goals should be in every possible area of your life. Academics is only one thing. And today, when you talk about academic goals, I had a student who enrolled for PhD when he was 78 years old. So, where is the question of restrictions? Academically, the rest of your life, you can keep, studying and gaining knowledge. It could be to do with relationships. It could be to do with hobbies. It could be to do with having very nice, enjoyable vacations with your loved ones. So, this is how you keep setting goals and you keep modifying goals. You keep accepting failures or setbacks or defeats. Keep making course corrections and, most important, enjoying the journey. Okay, so now let us see how we can set goals. If you understand the concept that you can't all the time be just sitting, relaxing, saying, let something happen, we'll see. You can't say that when a fire breaks out in my house, then I will go and buy a fire extinguisher. Life is also like that. So you have to think. After thinking, if you decide that no, I have got enough resources, I know I will not regret later that I didn't set goals. I will not run into financial or relationship or health problems, then it's okay. Otherwise, what do you do? I listed it down in some basic, 7 points, which I thought I will share with you. Anis is putting on the slide what we refer to as SMART goals. You must have heard about SMART goals. Okay. You should set SMART goals. At the same time, you should also set goals which are long term, which can be as lofty as possible, which may look totally out of reach, which may look like you may not be able to accomplish it in the next 50 years also, doesn't matter. When you set very lofty long-term goals, you start looking higher. You start becoming positive. You start becoming optimistic. At the same time, you should have short-term goals, and every short-term goal should be firstly achievable. Secondly, it should take you one step towards your long-term goals, right? Now, go back. Yeah. The important thing here is this is something which I very strongly believe in. When you set goals, you should believe in them. You should not do it only to impress others. Starting from children, who say that I want to become a software engineer because that is what my father wants me to be. I want to become a doctor so that everybody else will be impressed and it is a noble profession and all that. I want to become a chartered accountant because I know chartered accountants earn big money and something like that. That is not the way you set goals. And I'm giving an example of careers. It can be for anything. I want to build a big house because all my relatives are living in big houses. No. You should believe in your goal. And you should not do it to impress others. You should not do it out of comparison with others. You should not do it to be one step ahead of others. Keep that in mind. Then, remember, it should be in your control. be realistic, no? And particularly when we are talking about short-term goals, is it in your control or is it not? People come and say, my father's good friend and relative is some big politician, so I will talk to him and I will ask him to allot me a plot of land so that I can build a house, or I will ask him to get me a government job. Those are not goals, because they're not in your control. You're depending on your father, firstly, to speak to his relative, who is an influential person, who may or may not agree, who may or may not have that control. He may be an influential person, but he may not be in a position to allot plots or to get jobs for you. So do not pass the buck. Passing the buck when you are setting goals is a very, very dangerous thing to do. People who say, I will tell my father to talk to so-and-so, etc., and get me this. That does not work. So do not pass the buck when you are, you know, setting goals. If my wife improves her behavior, then I will also work towards improving my relationship with her. That is passing the buck. That is putting the onus on somebody else. If my son gets 95%, then I will pay donation and I will get him this admission. No. Your goals should be goals which are in your control. And that is the reason why I said that there is a difference between process goals and end goals. If you have process goals, I will steadily keep improving my marks. I will make efforts to see that my relationship with my partner becomes more and more harmonious as the days go past. I will work towards improving my health by doing various things, whether it is exercise or nutrition or whatever it is, so that my health improves. I've become overweight. I will constantly work towards reducing my weight, at least 1 kilo every 2 months. So these are all process goals. What are end goals? I will cut down my weight to 68 kilos. I will build a house which has got 4 bedrooms and which is in a big plot. I will take up only a class 1 officer's post in the government. Those are end goals. People who set end goals are like people who say, I want 100% marks in the exam. Even if they get 99, they are disappointed. But if it was a process goal, what would the person say? I have got 75%. I want to improve at least by 5% every term. So then, even if you get 80, 85, 90, you are very happy. So process goals get you achievement, fulfillment, happiness. End goals inevitably end up with getting you frustration. Now here is the next point. That is irreversible decisions, burning your boats, as they say. The moment you take a decision from where there is no coming back, which is what happens if you do not have a plan B ready. If you do not have any other options, you are stuck to only one thing. You have burnt your boats, which is what I see a lot of people doing every now and then. You should learn from earlier failures, whether it is your own or whether it is somebody else's. I'm sure you all know the story about Edison, who believed that an electric bulb can emit light. And he kept on trying and trying and trying and trying. And he used 100 different methods to make a bulb. It didn't succeed. But when somebody pointed out saying you're a failure, he said, no. I have found out 100 ways in which a bulb cannot be made. And he continued. It was a process goal. So one fine day, he actually managed to make an electric bulb. keep setting higher goals or different goals continuously. Don't be complacent with one goal. Like I told you, no, the day I have a big bungalow of my own, I will be a happy person. The day I have so much money in the bank account, I will be very happy. The day my daughter becomes a doctor, I will be thrilled with it. No. Keep setting different goals, higher goals on a continuous basis. These are some of the very, very relevant points. At the same time, I also have this thing of saying that divide major goals into sub-goals and keep monitoring them. And like I mentioned earlier, your short-term goals should take you one step towards your long-term goals. And lastly, before I show you a very interesting video which we recorded particularly for this session of today, remember to bring about change when it is not absolutely needed. If you are desperate, you have to make a change. You are fed up of your job or you are getting thrown out of the job, or you cannot tolerate your boss, you want to get out. If you want to make a change at that time, it will not be good. If you say, I have a job, I'm earning money, but I want a better job. That is when you bring about a change, you will be far more successful. So I come back to the original title of today's talk, that is, goals versus enjoying life. So there are these wise people who want the youngsters to all set goals. And there are some youngsters who say, so what? I can enjoy my life today. Just watch this little video.
What are you doing?
Nothing. I'm just chilling.
You can't do that. You seem to be educated and from a good family. Go get up, do some work.
And then what?
You will get some money, you will have dignity and satisfaction.
And what?
You work hard, you will get a promotion and more respect in society.
And then what?
You will have savings, you can build a house and have comforts.
And then what?
Finally, you will make a name for yourself and you will be able to retire gracefully.
Okay. And then what?
Then you will be able to relax and enjoy life.
Huh, that is what I'm doing right now, relaxing and enjoying my life.
Okay, that was in a lighter vein, but the same fact remains. If you know how to enjoy life, if you know that yes, I am doing what I want to, I am on the correct path. And I don't have to be competitive. I don't have to necessarily look for higher goals or compete with other persons. You're a very, very happy person. But I end up with what I told you 2 minutes back, that unless and until you start thinking of change, anticipate change, adapt to change, and have your goals ready to bring about the change whenever it is needed. Don't wait till circumstances force you to bring about a change. So start with thinking that, okay, life is fine. I am relaxed. I am contented. But I would still like to set some goals to improve my quality of life. And then sit and watch and see, when do I need to bring in, to what extent I need to bring in, and what should I do to bring in those changes, or can I wait for some more time and see as and when the change is required. So I've ended whatever I wanted to tell you. Sonal is here. She'll give you a quick update on what's happening in Banjara. And I
right, lovely topic, lovely weather, and good afternoon to all of you. Enjoying Ali's talk. and to give you update about what's happening at Banjara. As I was listening to Ali, before I update you, I'll just tell you what was happening in my mind. Very recently, I met a 16-year-old boy, again, having learning difficulty. But listen to his maturity. When I asked him, how do you make friends? He is telling, I make sure I make friends who have goals in life so that I stay motivated with him. And I'm in an environment which is positive, so that when we discuss, we talk something, it should be, you know, like taking us forward and not making us feel bad, right? Isn't it a wonderful and very matured way of thinking about life? Yes. Hi, Preeti, Vinita, Surekha, good afternoon, everyone. Yeah. Okay. And what's the update is our diploma in counseling skills course has started, but as every year it happens, once it starts, then the alumni says, can you accommodate one more seat? Can you accommodate one more seat? This is the phase to yet accommodate. Okay. So very soon the admissions will start closing. So if you know anybody would benefit from diploma in counseling skills, who wants to bring in a change in their career, right? Who want to have a goal in life, to, you know, have a meaningful goal, you can suggest them, come over. Anis will help them understand, then let them take their decision. But even if that little spark is there, don't leave it unturned. Send them to Anis. She will help them understand what is it all about. When they come over here, they meet Ali, then they meet me, they meet Purni. Sometimes what happens, even if you have not gone to that specific place, you have unknown doubts. Once you go, meet, talk, your doubts get cleared. So that happens when they come, and then they take their own decision. Absolutely fine, right? Then one more wonderful update. On 2nd of August, we have a webinar on what all a person who chooses career in psychology can specialize in. And the webinar is completely free. And the webinar will be done by none other than Dr. Ali himself. So if at all anybody wants to join this webinar, get in touch with office and a link will be sent to you. Once you register, registration is completely free. It's just that we know whom to let the person in the meeting. That's it, nothing about it. So even if you are in a field of counseling, or if you are interested in psychology, or you are a parent or a teacher or a student by itself, just grab this opportunity to listen to Dr. Ali. And he's back here again for you all for the topic to go ahead. Goals versus enjoying life.
Yes, I have come back again, and now we shall start with your comments and your questions. As usual, some very, very nice inputs I get every week from Surekha, and hers is the first, where she says, balancing the pursuit of goals with taking time to savor life's simple pleasures can lead to a more well-rounded and fulfilling existence. That's the sum total of what I have been saying in the first half hour. Do not be so busy making a living that you forget how to live. Do not be competing with others. I started the first thing by saying that your goals, your striving, your work should be for your satisfaction, and not to prove to somebody or not to compete with somebody. Okay. Shobha says actors are so nice. Yes, we have some real good budding talent in Banjara. And you are also welcome if any one of you wants to come and participate. We want to have more such videos every time. because they add, you know, spice to this session, and otherwise you'll all the time be just staring at my face. Surekha also says, our focus should be upon progression and not perfection. This way we will work towards our goals and enjoy every little milestone that we achieve. Surekha has put in very good words what I also said a few minutes back, that if your aim is to score 100 out of 100 in an exam, even if you get 99, you'll be a disappointed person. So no perfection, no 100 out of 100 in real life. But if you say that I am right now scoring 70, I want to improve it. I want to see whether I can make it to 80 or at least 75. Once I do that, then I will aim higher than that. That's how it should be. Yes, Rekha says goals and enjoying life are two sides of the same coin. Exactly. While goals can contribute to a sense of purpose and progress, it's important not to become so focused on them that you forget to enjoy the journey and the little moments that make life meaningful. Yes. Archana says, good afternoon. I looked the way the boy responded to you. I wish all youngsters would have similar mindset. We will have a better world around. Yes, that's how it should be. A good balance. Put in your hard work, make your efforts, keep progressing, but you don't necessarily have to have such great goals that I will be the boss of my office, I will be having a big bungalow, and I will have a big bank balance and all these things, right? Arjun also says, I like the way the boy responded to you, ma'am. Wish youngsters now have a similar mindset. Vinita says, I think setting goals helps us to lead our lives in a certain direction. That's very important. And we can also enjoy life as well. It's connected. Whenever I go out of town, particularly by road, I make it a point to look around. There are some interesting dhabas, there is some greenery, there are some fields. I stop and see a sunflowers field, and I look at those sunflowers and I say, are they really, you know, looking towards the sun? How come they are looking in that direction? That's what we do on a road journey should be the same as what we do in our life journey. Shobha says, even so many people forced me not to study MA in psychology. But Ali, you only pushed me to do master's in psychology. Now I am thrilled to do the degree as I am working as a teacher. In fact, every teacher, like Shobha did, should know about human behavior, child behavior, how to reach out to people and connect with them. It should be an essential part of life, no? Okay, if that is not being taught to you in your B.Ed and M.Ed and all that, at least we should make that effort. It is people like Shobha who take that extra step to make those efforts and say, okay, I am a qualified teacher, I'm competent, I have a good job, I'm doing a good job of it, but I will add to my qualifications. Just because I'm in midlife doesn't mean that I'm just going to relax now for the rest of so many years and then retire happily at 60 years of age. That is what I have been trying to convey through today's session. Sridevi says, while process goals allow one to feel accomplished when they meet tiny milestones and help them stay motivated, end goals can cause restlessness, anxiety about failures, and self-doubt. That is what I have been trying to tell you. Do not set those end goals, that ultimate thing. Only if I get absolute Mr. Right or Miss Right, then only I'll marry. Only if I can buy a Mercedes car, then I will buy a car. Otherwise, I will not buy a car. Only if I get a job with so much salary, then only I'll take up a job. Otherwise, I will not take up a job. Those are the people who suffer badly. Surekha says, learn to put everything you got into everything you do. That way, working towards a goal and enjoying. Investment in your efforts would be very fulfilling. Surekha has used the right word, investment in your efforts. Are you investing in your life through your efforts? If you are doing that, then you are on the right track. Every time you make an investment, you do a course correction. You decide that this is where I am going to enjoy the journey. This is what I was looking up for. Or even, as I mentioned earlier, start changing your goal. There was a time when I wanted to do this. For example, in our DCS program, no? Every year we get people who are highly qualified engineers. At that time, people told them that, you know, you take up software engineering, this, that, you'll have a very good career, you'll make big money. And they put in all their effort. They really struggled. They saw to it that they got into good institutions. They passed out with good marks. They got into very good organizations. They have a very good track record. But somewhere they have started thinking, is this what I'm going to be doing the rest of my life? Is the purpose of my life to make more and more software programs or this or that or whatever it is? Don't I want to have something more meaningful and more thing, whether it gets me money or not? And that is when they take these type of changes. And I'm so impressed. I feel so happy when they take that risk, that chance, and they say, let me move in the direction which I want. I know financially I will suffer. I know many of my own people will put me down and say, what are you doing? You're stupid. How can you give up such a big well-paying job and get into this? But in the long run, they are very, very fulfilled people. I keep coming across such people who take that risk, who decide that earlier, maybe I didn't have the opportunity, or maybe I was too naive. I just followed what my elders and everybody else told me. And I have no regrets. I have achieved something. I am good at whatever I am doing, but it's not fulfilling. Now that I have reached certain such an age, I do want to bring about a change in my life. So I will explore, I'll find out what is good for me, and I will change direction and start moving in a different direction. And Suman rightly says, age should not hinder making goals. Goals add essence to our life. I think I had mentioned this very long back. My grandfather retired from a very respectable high position in government. Those days, you had to go to the pension payment office and collect your pension at the first of the month. He used to go there, and because he had retired from a good position, the people there used to respect him, give him his pension immediately, and he would go away. But he realized that there are a lot of people who come from the poorer sector, people who are peons or clerks or whatever you want to call them. And this pension payment office people used to really harass them. One day when he saw one such pensioner being harassed, he went up to that clerk and said, why are you harassing him? This is his right. Pension is what he has earned after 30, 40 years of service. It's his money. That man looked up at him and said, sir, whenever you come, we treat you with respect and we give you without any complaint, right? Are you his advocate? Why are you talking on his behalf? My grandfather kept quiet, went home, thought, and said, am I his advocate? No, I'm not. But can I be his advocate? Yes, I can. So at that age, he enrolled in college, studied, and got himself a legal degree. And every month he used to go to the pension payment office. And whenever he would find that some poor retired employee is being harassed, he would put on his black coat, walk in, and say, I am his advocate. If you harass him, I will pull you to court. And that fellow used to get so scared that he would immediately do the work. He never had to go to court, by the way, because that black coat and his tone and the fact that he's a qualified advocate was enough. So you see, you can set goals at any age, like someone said. Okay, Surekha says, the goal could be that I will respond in ways that they will appreciate me. Enjoying life is in saying, I'll be okay if they don't. Yes, I know I'm on the right track. I have started on a journey which I am enjoying and which is taking me in the right direction. If they appreciate me, I'm happy. I will acknowledge, I will be grateful to them, I will acknowledge them. But even if they do not, I will still be okay. My success, my fulfillment, my sense of contentment should not depend on what others say, particularly those others who do not matter. Yes, there are some important people in your life whose opinion matters. I always say that give credence to them. Do things which, if not, even if they don't make you happy, they at least feel okay with it. And then you pursue your dreams and you go in the direction that you want to. So it's been a nice and enjoyable afternoon as always for me. And if you have enjoyed it, continue to participate and spread the word around. Every now and then I come across people who say, oh, I didn't know, Ali, that you have this Saturday program. I was not aware of it. So within your friends, you know who are the type of people who like to understand more about human behavior and things like that, you know, who want to improve their quality of life and also want to reach out to others and improve their quality of life. So if you feel that this little webinar of every Saturday can be useful to some people around you, just spread the word, tell them. It's very easy. They just have to log into Banjara's Facebook page and they can watch the whole thing. And in case Saturday 2 o'clock is not convenient for them, they can watch it later. It continues to remain on screen and you can, whenever you are free, you can watch it. But in the second case, you will not be able to participate in the discussion. You cannot give your comments or ask questions. That's the only difference. So with that, now Anis will show you what we are going to be doing next Saturday. That is the 3rd of August. I'm going to initiate a discussion on why do we form negative opinion about people? Why is it that we gossip? Why is it that we are so free in putting others down? That, if you can take care of that, if you can be aware, why am I doing it, and bring about a tactical change within yourself, it will really benefit you. And you will find that you get very good, true and sustained relationships with the right person. So that's the topic. Before next Saturday, if you have some points or tips for that, let me know. Please share it with me by phone or by message or by email or whatever it is. But in case you do not have any clear ideas, do join us on 2 o'clock next Saturday. That is 3rd of August, and we'll discuss ahead. Yes, Sharayu says that missed many but caught on, to listening. Thank you, Sharayu. It is compliments from very educated, very sincere, and very mature people like you, which keeps motivating me to continue on my really humble mission that I have taken up. So have a wonderful weekend and see you again next Saturday.
You can't do that. You seem to be educated and from a good family. Go get up, do some work.
And then what?
You will get some money, you will have dignity and satisfaction.
And what?
You work hard, you will get a promotion and more respect in society.
And then what?
You will have savings, you can build a house and have comforts.
And then what?
finally you will make a name for yourself and you will be able to retire gracefully.
Okay, and then what?
Then you will be able to relax and enjoy life.
Huh, that is what I'm doing right now, relaxing and enjoying my life.